Life appears sparse in the deep sea, as the lack of sunlight prevents photosynthesis from taking place, and animals must rely on scraps of food sinking from above. However, on the ocean floor, there are important regions where primary production is possible via a mechanism called chemosynthesis. In part one, we delved into the significance of hydrothermal vents in supporting uniquely specialized communities of life in the depths. But vents are not the only seafloor regions where primary productivity can occur. Along continental margins and down in oceanic trenches, we find cold seeps. Regions where cool, hydrocarbon-rich water escapes from the ocean floor and provides the necessary conditions for chemosynthetic assemblages to form. These mirror vent systems in a number of ways, but they give rise to an alternative set of conditions for life to adapt to and exploit. Let's dive in and explore the biology that thrives here, the geology that anchors it, and the chemistry that fuels it. The geological origins of cold seeps differs from hydrothermal vents. While vents form from volcanic activity at seafloor spreading regions, cold seeps instead arise at the other end of oceanic plates, where they are subducted at the continental margin. Their formation begins with the burial of organic material under sediments on the seafloor. These organic compounds degrade over time, producing methane. Geological processes like the tectonic compression of sediments at subduction zones forces the methane from deep reservoirs up through the overlying sediments. Anaerobic microbes dwelling below the sediment surface oxidise this methane using sulphate, producing hydrogen sulphide and bicarbonate ions as a byproduct. This hydrogen sulphide, along with any residual methane, then serves as a vital energy source for chemosynthetic microbes. Thus, it is a consortium of two distinct sets of microbes that makes primary productivity possible at cold seeps, and lays the foundations of food webs here. The result is an environment remarkably similar to hydrothermal vents. We have a flux of sulphide and methane at the sea floor, chemosynthetic microbes using these compounds, and an abundance of life exploiting this productivity. Fulfilling similar ecological niches and forming biodiversity hotspots in the deep sea. Seventy percent of the Earth's surface is abyssal plain, a great, flat, sediment-covered region of the deep sea floor, characterized by low biodiversity due to the absence of primary productivity. But upon finding a cold seep, you're met with a seafloor region that's booming with life. Beds of bathymodiolus mussels, endemic to chemosynthetic oases, encase the landscape. These animals seem to dominate chemosynthetic communities due to their ability to form an endosymbiotic association with the microbes. They host the bacteria within their gills and benefit directly from the food and energy they produce. The mussels also support other species, grazers like gastropods and orbinid polychaetes, as well as scavengers like shrimp and squat lobsters, picking at organic detritus produced by the mussels. Siboglinid tube worms, belonging to the same family as the tube worms of hydrothermal vents, can be found here too. In a similar fashion to vent tube worms, they allow microbes to inhabit their internal trophosome, an organ specially adapted for housing chemosynthetic microbes. But one key difference between tube worms at vents and seeps arises from seep environments being soft sedimented rather than hard rock. Hydrothermal vents are located at mid-ocean ridges where sediment hasn't had time to accumulate on the newly formed oceanic crust. So the worms must obtain the sulphides from the water via their plume. In contrast, cold seep tube worms are able to burrow down into sediments and take up sulphide via their roots rather than just the plumes. They're even able to establish their extensive root system in the hard carbonate rocks that form at cold seeps. The continuous supply of sulphides sustains them for very long periods of time, allowing them to be slow growing. It's estimated that they may be able to live for over 200 years, forming tube worm bushes, which can contain hundreds of individual worms. Just like the mussel beds, these bushes create a complex 3D environment that supports a range of other organisms. Nestled among the cracks and crevices created by the mussel beds, we find another cold seep denizen you might recognize from hydrothermal vents. Although these yeti crabs are a different species to the ones at vents, they exhibit a similar trophic adaptation and farm colonies of bacteria on their bodies as epibionts inhabiting their surface. These crabs have developed long, hairy, claw-bearing arms, or chelae, which they wave directly in the sulfide-rich seepage. Predatory organisms such as octopuses, fish, and larger crabs are attracted to this vibrant community to complete the food chain. Incredibly, the abundant life of cold seeps significantly reduces the flux of methane from the sea floor to the water column, for organisms here represent the only biological methane sink in the ocean. This is called the benthic filter. At cold seeps with bacterial mats, it's thought that between 50 and 90% of released methane is consumed and taken out of the system. Since methane is a potent greenhouse gas which contributes to a warming climate, this consumption of methane by seafloor life has a major impact on regulating the global climate. Variations in the underlying geological processes can give rise to different types of cold seep environment, often with distinct communities adapted to the unique abiotic challenges. Types of cold seep include mud volcanoes, gas hydrate beds, asphalt seeps, and brine pools. Mud volcanoes form when methane gas and warm fluidized mud rise from over a kilometer beneath the sea floor, exploding out of the sediment in pulses. Over time, this builds up mud in the shape of a cone that protrudes from the sea floor and may be many kilometers wide. This is perhaps the most challenging cold seep variety for life to inhabit, as the soft, flowing mud makes it almost impossible for animals to settle. But along the borders of mud volcanoes, beyond the region prone to eruption, we occasionally find bacterial mats and meadows of tube worms thriving on the methane. Not all sites of methane seepage form mud volcanoes. Methane hydrate, sometimes called methane ice, is a frozen form of methane combined with water that forms in high-pressure, low-temperature conditions, meaning it's stable here at the deep sea floor, where it forms mounds. During their 2017 expedition in the Gulf of Mexico, NOAA's remotely operated vehicle encountered these gas hydrate mounds at depths of around 1,050 meters. On the outcrops themselves, the only macrofauna identified as living directly on the methane hydrate was a species of polychaete called ice worms. At only 2 to 4 centimeters long, these worms burrow into the hydrate, creating small depressions and survive by grazing on chemosynthetic bacteria that grow on the hydrate surface. Around the edges, streams of methane bubbles could be seen rising up towards the surface, sometimes encased in clear tubes of hydrate. The bubbles seem to attract assemblages of fish, darting in and out of the streams of bubbling methane, as well as fields of anemones and sea stars. This footage, captured by M. Barry scientists in 2011, shows a deep-sea crab mistaking the movement of a stream of methane for food. As it came in contact with the bubbles, the gas solidified, coating the crab's claws and freezing its mouthparts together, forming a milk moustache of solid hydrate. At around 3,000 meters below sea level, also in the Gulf of Mexico, scientists discovered that vast areas of the sea floor were covered with swathes of asphalt. These asphalt seeps formed when petroleum deposits deep beneath the sea floor leaked out into the water. Lighter components rose up towards the surface and left behind denser hydrocarbons that solidified on the seabed. The result is an underwater landscape that resembles a cooled lava field. But despite seeming inhospitable, a unique community of organisms has been found living on and around the asphalt, exhibiting a new kind of cold seep habitat that remains poorly understood. In 2014, a sonar showed a cluster of structures at a depth of 1,900 meters, also in the Gulf of Mexico, with a large size indicative of a sunken wreck. When explorers from NOAA approached the site with their ROV, they stumbled upon an enormous formation, splayed out over the seabed like a flower. Later dubbed a tar lily, this was discovered to be an extrusion of asphalt. The thick, gooey hydrocarbon mass had been squeezed out from deep reservoirs in rope-like formations that bent and flowed into petal shapes, becoming hard and brittle over time. More volatile hydrocarbons dissolved, so the petals shrunk. Cracks formed, and the lily provided a hard substrate that bacteria could colonize, using the oil for primary production and transforming this extrusion into a localized chemosynthetic paradise. Anemones and corals anchor themselves on the ledges, while tube worms are wedged among the many fractures. Another process, salt dipyrism, occurs when salt flats are buried beneath other types of sediment. The salt layer is more buoyant, so it pushes its way to the surface, forming dipyrs or vertical intrusions through the overlying sediment, like salt domes and pillars. Some of the salt dissolves and flows into the dipyrs to form a lake of dense anoxic hypersaline water called a brine pool. This can be 5 times saltier than normal seawater. And it's the presence of dissolved methane in the brine that means these surreal pools often coincide with cold seep activity, allowing for chemosynthetic life to thrive. But what makes brine pools unique among cold seep environments is the zonation of the life found here. Due to the toxic nature of the brine itself, animals are limited to inhabiting just the shores of these unusual lakes. The mussel beds form a 5-meter-wide ring that encircles the lake. Dwelling any closer to the brine will result in toxic shock, while living further away will starve the endosymbiotic bacteria living in their gills of the necessary compounds for chemosynthesis. The insular nature of cold seeps is similar to hydrothermal vents. They can be considered islands of abundance on the sea floor, isolated from one another in patches dotted along the continental margins. But they are also transitory, existing only briefly, with the seepage of any one site not lasting forever. To understand how the activity of cold seeps ends, we need to take another look at the process of methane oxidation within the sediments. As a byproduct of the reaction that forms hydrogen sulfide for chemosynthesis, bicarbonate ions are released. The bicarbonate ions react with calcium in seawater to create calcium carbonate in the form of biogenic rock. This explains the origins of carbonate reefs, towering rock chimneys, and spires that protrude from the sea floor at cold seeps, supporting assemblages of life and microbial reefs for a brief period, before eventually blocking the seepage altogether. The size of carbonate reefs in some regions of the Atlantic indicates that persistent seepage may have been taking place for an estimated 15,000 years. This self-destructive process may give rise to a pattern of ecological succession at certain cold seeps, beginning with the arrival of bacteria that aggregate into mats. During this initial stage, colonies of mussels form near the seep, along with their associated fauna. Carbonate outcrops begin to form, attracting tube worms which settle and live alongside the mussels. Once seepage is blocked, the mussel beds are starved. But tubeworm meadows live on a little while longer due to their ability to burrow down and tap into the sulphide flux directly. When the carbonate cap grows too large for even tubeworms to access the sulphides, all that remains is a lifeless rocky outcrop. But there may be another stage to this succession, as the die-off of tubeworms clears the way for colonization by stony corals. The corals, along with other sessile animals, make use of these outcrops as vital attachment points amidst the soft muds of the abyssal plain. The deep-sea coral gardens shown here are formed around structures that may well have once been sites of chemosynthetic activity in the form of cold seeps centuries prior. In conclusion, cold seeps are an unusual collection of deep-sea habitats that show off the ability of life to make the most of an energy source in the most challenging of environments. From carpets of asphalt seeping from ancient hydrocarbon deposits, to explosive mud volcanoes and toxic lakes of brine, these regions push the limits of adaptation in the depths. But they also bring to light the importance of some deep-sea communities in helping to regulate our climate through providing a benthic filter for potent greenhouse gases like methane. Although they may be far removed and out of sight, creatures of the deep provide a vital service that benefits the global biosphere. In part 3, we'll explore seafloor habitats that provide partial chemosynthetic oases for life. From sulfophilic communities at whale carcasses that thrive on lipids stored in bone, to woodfalls and the vibrant ecosystems that bloom at shipwrecks, making the most of these unexpected energy sources. This portion of the video is sponsored by NordVPN. Just like how creatures of the deep have adapted their lifestyles to evade predators, online browsing is evolving too. By connecting to any one of over 5,100 servers in 60 countries, you can protect your identity and data online with NordVPN in just one click. And just like how autotomy in some squid allows them to eject their tentacles when threatened, NordVPN has an automatic kill switch for extra security. If your VPN connection accidentally drops, it temporarily blocks the device from accessing the web. In addition, NordVPN is offering Natural World Facts viewers an exclusive deal. Simply visit nordvpn.com/naturalworldfacts or use the coupon code NaturalWorldFacts to access this exclusive deal.